If you zoom in 10 billion times, you encounter the atom, the smallest basic building block to all matter in the universe. They're even smaller than molecules and macromolecules, which go on to build organelles. Organelles fit inside of cells, cells make up tissues, tissues make up organs, organs make up organ systems, and finally, the organism. In today's topic, we'll look at biochemistry and the different types of molecules that help a cell function and survive. The atom is the smallest basic unit of all matter in the universe. It's comprised of a nucleus, which contains protons and neutrons. The number of protons determines what kind of element it is. And around the nucleus, you have electrons which orbit in different energy levels, and it's the interactions of an atom's electrons that determines what kind of molecule it makes. Atoms of different elements can link up and they can bond together to form different compounds and molecules. In the illustration to your left, you could see how water is formed when hydrogen bonds and shares electrons with oxygen. You can also see how CO2 or carbon dioxide is formed when oxygen bonds with carbon. Ions form when atoms either gain or lose electrons. Electrons are negatively charged particles, which means when you lose electrons, overall you become more positive. You become a positive ion. When you gain electrons, you're taking on something that's negative. Overall, your charge becomes more negative. You can see in the illustrations how sodium gives up one of its electrons to chlorine to form sodium chloride. Sodium has now become an ion. Chlorine becomes an ion, and those two combine to form a compound we call salt. Covalent bonding is a sharing of electrons. It's different from ionic bonds, where one atom just completely gives up its electron to a different atom. In covalent bonding, two atoms are sharing electrons. You can see in the illustration how these hydrogen atoms are sharing electrons to form a bond. The most important covalent molecule on planet Earth is obviously water, or H2O. You can see in the diagram how hydrogen is sharing electrons with oxygen to form a molecule of water. Water is also polar, which means it has a slight static charge. This polarity lends water many of its incredible properties. To give you a better idea of what is meant by the phrase water is polar, or water has polarity, I provided you with a 3D model. You can see in the model how oxygen is colored red. Red just means that it's slightly negative. And the reason why it's more negative is because oxygen is more electronegative. It wants the electrons a little bit more than the hydrogens do. So there's this unequal sharing of electrons. Meanwhile, the hydrogens are colored blue because they're slightly positive. And when you have two different regions on this molecule, one side is positive, the other side is negative, we say that it's polar. It's kind of like North Pole and South Pole, or North and South on a magnet. It's just two different contrasting areas on the same molecule. And because they have this sort of effect, it gives water many of its special properties, all because of polarity. Water can form a special type of bond, known as hydrogen bonds. They're illustrated in the pictures above me, and they're represented with the dotted lines. You could see how an oxygen on one water molecule is attracted to hydrogen of a different water molecule. It's this slight attraction, or this hydrogen bonding, that gives water its special abilities and properties. Because of hydrogen bonding, water has many special properties. The first one is a really high boiling point. So compared to other molecules that are around the same size and mass, water has an extremely high boiling point. It's a liquid at room temperature, and it doesn't boil until 100 degrees Celsius. Meanwhile, if you compare that with something like CO2 or carbon dioxide, the air that you're exhaling right now, carbon dioxide is a gas at room temperature because it's boiled off already, has a really low boiling point compared to water. Water also has a high specific heat. The specific heat is the energy required to change the temperature of 1 gram of water by 1 degree Celsius. It takes a lot of energy to change the temperature of water. Water absorbs a lot of heat. You can see in the looping video, I coated my hand with water, so the water absorbs the heat from the flames, keeping me safe. You can see in the image to your left, the balloon pops instantly because there's no water inside to absorb the heat. Meanwhile, in the image to the right, the water balloon is absorbing all the heat, so it takes quite some time before the balloon pops. This illustrates the fact that water has a high specific heat. It takes a lot of energy, it absorbs a lot of heat before its temperature starts to change. Because of water's high specific heat, this allows our oceans to absorb a lot of heat from the sun and infrared sources, keeping our climate stable. Without the ocean's water, Earth would just be a dry, barren planet. Alright, I can't get enough of hydrogen bonding, but this is kind of related to that. So a third special property of water is that it has cohesion. So all the water molecules tend to stick with each other, thus creating high surface tension, and that's why you could see bugs like the water strider go across the surface and walk across its surface like it's Jesus or something. In contrast to cohesion, water also has another special ability or property known as adhesion. Adhesion is the attraction to different molecules. So water is sticky and it tends to stick to other surfaces that are polar and have slight charges. This also explains capillary action. So water is transported up through the stems and trunks of certain plants and trees against the force of gravity because of adhesion. The water molecules tend to stick along the sides of the stem and they travel upwards. Many of the important vital functions in your body require solutions. Typically, solutions are made from water because water is such a great solvent. The solvent is the thing that does the dissolving. The solute is the thing that's dissolved in the water. When you put the two together, you have a solution. And it makes sense because your body is mostly made of water. It can dissolve a lot of different things. Water is amphoteric, which means it can act as both an acid and a base. When it donates a proton or a hydrogen, it's acting like an acid. When it receives a proton or when it receives a hydrogen, it's acting like a base. Everyone knows that water is neutral and has a pH of 7, which is why it's amphoteric. It can act as both an acid and a base. But many solutions in your body which carry out vital important functions are either an acid or a base. An acid has a pH less than 7. They usually taste sour, but they also conduct electricity in solution. Bases, on the other hand, feel slippery, they taste bitter, but they're important in dissolving fats and oils in your cells. So we'll learn all about acids and bases at some other time, but just keep this stuff in mind. I think I'll stop here and I'll call this Biochemistry Part 1. But before I go, I'll provide you with a summary of what we just learned. So I discuss what the atom is and its structure. It has protons and neutrons in the nucleus, and it's surrounded by electrons in its orbit. It's the interactions of these electrons that make up different compounds and molecules. Next, we learned about the polarity of water and how it has special things like hydrogen bonds. These hydrogen bonds allow water to have a really high boiling point, high specific heat, special abilities like cohesion and adhesion. And finally, I gave you a brief introduction to things like solutions, acids, and bases. I'll see you next time on Wind Biology. Thanks for watching.